So, hi everybody. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Dawn Erb from the University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee. I've known Dawn for a while, and she's worked a lot extensively on the rest frame optical properties of high redshift galaxies, and now also, as you'll see today, a lot about the ultraviolet properties of distant galaxies. Dawn got her undergraduate degree at University of Washington, Seattle, and went on for a PhD at Caltech with Chuck Seidel there, who's one of the astronomy faculty. She then went on to a fellowship at the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics as the CFA fellow, and then moved to UC Santa Barbara as a Spitzer Space Telescope, so Spitzer Fellowship, which is a fellowship sponsored by the institute that runs the Spitzer Space Telescope. Following that, she moved to University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee as a faculty, where she's been continuing her work. So it's really nice that we've had her here. She gave the keynote address at the MARAC meeting on Saturday, which was also really wonderful. So we get two talks for one visit, which is great. So it's my pleasure to welcome her. So,
thanks, Greg, and thanks everyone for having me. I've enjoyed my visit. This is my first visit to Kansas, and it's been a lot of fun. So thank you for having me. I'll start just by saying that I know that not all of you are astronomers, and I'm going to try to take that into account. But if I slip into astronomy jargon or start to say words that don't make sense, please stop and ask questions, and I'll try to clarify. So I'm going to tell you about what I've been thinking about for the past few years, and this is low-mass galaxies and their gas at the peak epoch of star formation. And as we go through, I'll explain what I mean by low-mass galaxies and what I mean by the peak epoch of star formation and all of these various things. And also, of course, this is not work that I've done by myself, and in particular, Danielle Berg, who is a postdoc working with me in Milwaukee, has done a lot of the work that I'm going to show you towards the end of the talk. So, in the big picture, this is really about the formation and evolution of galaxies. And the study of the formation and evolution of galaxies is really the study of the growth of structure in the universe. So we have a map of what the density of the universe looked like 400,000 years after the Big Bang in the form of the cosmic microwave background radiation. And that showed us that the universe is extremely smooth. There are density fluctuations of 1 part in 10 to the 5. Whereas if we look around us today, the universe doesn't look like that at all. We have galaxies, and we have clusters of galaxies, and we have voids of empty space in between them. So this whole process of getting from one to the other is the growth and evolution of galaxies. And that proceeds through a process that we call hierarchical galaxy formation. And this is basically just the idea that small galaxies merge together to form larger galaxies. So this is just a little cartoon to represent that. But galaxies live in dark matter halos, and these dark matter halos merge together over time. So if we look back into the distant universe, we're looking back in time at very early galaxies, and those galaxies tend to be smaller and, of course, less evolved than the galaxies that we see around us today. And one of the things that I'm particularly interested in is how these galaxies have affected the universe, and in particular, some of the important transitions that the universe has gone through. So I talked about the cosmic microwave background, which is photons left over from the Big Bang that have just been streaming toward us ever since the universe became neutral, when it became cool enough for those protons and electrons to combine about 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And then we get to what is called the Dark Ages, where the universe was neutral for a very long time until the first stars and galaxies formed. And this led to something called reionization, which is perhaps the last major phase change in the history of the universe. So this is when we have all this neutral hydrogen pervading the universe, and then the first stars and galaxies began to form, and those stars and galaxies emitted ionizing radiation, so photons with energies above 13.6 eV, sufficient to ionize hydrogen, and those ionized little bubbles of gas, which gradually overlapped until most of the hydrogen in between galaxies now was ionized, which is now the state that it's in today. So I will be talking more about this and why it's a little bit difficult to understand how this process actually took place. Before I get to that, I'll just show another little cartoon orienting you with our whole history of the universe here. So we have 13.8 billion years. So here is our cosmic microwave background, 400,000 years. The Dark Ages last for a long time. Here is reionization, just several hundred million years after the Big Bang. Most of the observations that I work on, the stuff that I'll be telling you about today, happen in here when the universe is 2 or 3 billion years old, something like that. And then you are over here another 10 billion years later. So that is the big picture. I want to get back to this issue of reionization and how this actually happened. So we're talking about ionizing photons escaping from early galaxies. This is just an artist's conception of what one of these early galaxies might have looked like. Of course, we don't have right now the sensitivity or spatial resolution to take pictures as pretty as this of these distant galaxies. So this is an artist's impression. But what we need is lots of ionizing radiation escaping from galaxies like this. And this is actually a difficult problem. One of the reasons why this is a difficult problem is illustrated by this figure here. These are pictures of galaxies, more local galaxies. That's what the images are. And then the contours that are superimposed on the images are from radio observations of neutral hydrogen gas from the 21 centimeter emission line. And so what you can see is that all of these galaxies are surrounded by neutral hydrogen. Galaxies in general are filled with and surrounded by neutral hydrogen gas. And neutral hydrogen gas absorbs hydrogen ionizing photons. So it's actually very difficult for these ionizing photons to get out of galaxies. So a big problem is figuring out how can we get enough photons to actually make reionization happen. We need a lot of galaxies, and we need those galaxies to be producing these photons, and we need those photons actually able to get out of these galaxies. So this brings us to the particular sort of galaxies that I'm interested in. So this is where I convince you that you should care about little, faint, dwarfy, low-mass galaxies. This is a plot called the UV, the luminosity function of galaxies. This is just a plot of the number of galaxies per unit volume in bins of luminosity. So this is the rest frame UV luminosity. This is a logarithmic magnitude scale down here. So here are bright galaxies. Here are faint galaxies. This particular plot is for galaxies at a redshift of 2 and a redshift of 3, which is in the universe was 20% or so of its current age. This is in this peak epoch of star formation, which I'll say more about shortly. But this part of this plot over here, this region is known as the faint end of the luminosity function, and the slope of this line here is the faint end slope. And it basically tells you how many faint low-mass galaxies you have in the universe. The steeper this slope is, the more faint galaxies you have. And if we were to compare this plot with the luminosity function of galaxies in the local universe, you would see that this slope is considerably steeper, meaning that there are a lot more of these faint low-mass galaxies at high redshifts, which is probably not surprising if you think about that picture of the hierarchical galaxy formation with your little galaxies merging to form big galaxies at later times. You might expect more faint, small, low-mass galaxies at higher redshifts. So we do see that at these redshifts 2 to 3, and we also see that this seems to be true for as far back in time as we can measure it, to the most distant redshifts. So that means that these galaxies are low mass and small, but there are a lot of them. So models that are trying to figure out how this reionization happened tend to require lots of faint galaxies. We need to have a steep slope in our luminosity function. Our galaxies, this line needs to keep going to even fainter luminosities. So all of these galaxies need to be producing ionizing photons, and some of them need to be able to get out of the galaxies. So what I'm interested in is studying the properties of these faint galaxies, and in particular, properties that might correlate with the escape of this ionizing radiation. It turns out that it's extremely difficult to measure this ionizing radiation directly for technological reasons, and it's extremely faint, and it's easy to get other galaxies that contaminate your observations. And so this is very hard to measure directly, but what we can do is study properties that we expect to be related to this ionizing photon escape. So that's a lot of what I'm going to talk about today.
I have a question.
Yes.
So it's the luminosity times the density integrated that makes the total amount. Where's the peak?
The peak of the luminosity function in?
I'm not going to ask for right. I'm not going to use the right language of luminosity function, but you have a number of galaxies per volume. You know, multiply that by the luminosity of each one, you get the total amount of radiation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so where's the peak in the luminosity times the number density?
So you're probably asking what range of luminosity galaxies contribute the bulk of the luminosity. In the local universe, it is there's a break in here. So this is an exponential cutoff, and then there's a power law slope, and there's a luminosity at the break, which we call L star. And in the local universe, galaxies around that luminosity actually contribute probably the bulk. These fainter galaxies get to be more important at higher redshifts. I don't have numbers for you for higher redshifts.
If the peak is outside the range you can measure.
I don't think so.
It depends on extrapolation.
It absolutely depends on extrapolation. There is definitely some floor in how faint this goes in terms of the minimum mass of galaxies that actually form stars. We don't know exactly what that is, and certainly at higher redshifts we're not seeing it. So there is absolutely extrapolation involved here. So one of the other properties that we're interested in galaxies in terms of their evolution in general, but also in the escape of ionizing radiation, is something that we call by many names. One of them is galactic outflows. So this is a picture of a galaxy which is not at redshift 2. This is M82, a very nearby galaxy. But this is the poster child for a galaxy undergoing this kind of galactic outflow. So this is a sort of ordinary looking disk galaxy, which you see here, but then in this red light, which is narrowband H-alpha emission, I believe, you can see that there's actually a bipolar outflow coming out from the center of the galaxy. So this galaxy has intense star formation in the nucleus, which is actually driving a wind, a significant amount of gas out of the galaxy on galactic scales. This is another picture of the same galaxy, but it also shows you some of this stuff in X-rays, combined with an optical infrared image here. I show this just to emphasize that these outflows are complicated multi-phase phenomena. So we have very hot gas heated up by supernovae, which you see in X-rays, cooler gas which gets entrained in that outflow. So we have a wide range of temperatures and densities involved. But these outflows certainly have a strong influence on the evolution of galaxies. Stars form out of gas, so if you take a bunch of gas and drive it out of your galaxy, or even just heat it up, that will tend to limit your star formation. So we know that these outflows are important in regulating star formation. They also clearly affect the distribution of gas in and around the galaxy. So they probably also have an effect on possible channels for these ionizing photons to escape. So I could show you a lot of different plots about these outflows and why they're important. I could talk about that for the whole talk, but I'm just going to show you a few reasons why these are important. First, This is showing you, so this is the halo mass of galaxies down here, the mass of the dark matter halo that they live in. And this is the ratio of the mass in stars to the halo mass of galaxies. And you can see that there is a peak here around 10 to the 12 solar masses, which is about the halo mass of the Milky Way, where galaxies have a maximum stellar to halo mass. So it seems that for whatever reason, at this particular mass, galaxies are most efficient at forming stars. If you go to both higher and lower masses, the stellar mass decreases relative to the halo mass. And the usual explanation for this in both cases is this kind of feedback process that affects the gas. At the higher mass end, we think it has to do with AGN activity, meaning accretion onto supermassive black holes at the centers of galaxies and feedback processes associated with that. At the lower mass end down here, it is probably feedback and outflows due to star formation. And you can see that this gap here gets larger and larger as you go to lower and lower masses. So clearly, at low mass galaxies, this is an important process. There are other reasons why we can tell that these outflows are important for the evolution of the universe. This is the spectrum of a quasar that you're looking at here. And this quasar has, so this is the Lyman alpha emission line and hydrogen emission line from the quasar itself. And blueward of that, you see a whole bunch of absorption lines. This is called the Lyman alpha forest. These absorption lines are due to bits of neutral hydrogen gas along the line of sight between us and the quasar. There are also, which you can see in this part of the spectrum, lines from what we call metals. If you're an astronomer, it's very convenient. Everything heavier than helium is a metal. So carbon, silicon, oxygen, all metals. And we see metal absorption lines from gas in between us and the quasar. And so this is the gas in the intergalactic medium in between galaxies. And you may know that hydrogen and helium formed in the Big Bang. Everything else, except for a little bit of lithium, was formed inside stars. Stars live in galaxies. We now have these various heavy elements in gas between galaxies. And it had to get there somehow. It had to get out of galaxies. So probably we are thinking that these galactic outflows drove gas enriched with byproducts of star formation into the intergalactic medium between galaxies. And we actually have evidence that this is happening. What you can do is correlate absorption line systems that you see in quasar spectra with the positions of galaxies. So this is just one example. There are a whole lot of different absorption lines from different elements here with all sorts of complicated structure that doesn't matter too much. But the point is that you can associate all of this absorption with a galaxy that is at an impact parameter of 115 kiloparsecs from the quasar line of sight. So here's your quasar. Your galaxy is 115 kiloparsecs off to the side. And what you're seeing is enriched gas, probably in or near the halo of that galaxy. So you can do this in a larger, more statistical sense and find that galaxies do influence their environment via this chemical enrichment to pretty large radii due to these galactic outflows. Here is just one more picture of outflows for you. These are results from simulations. And again, I just show you these to make the point that these are very complex, multi-phase, messy phenomenon. I'm going to be showing you some nice cartoons later, and you should contrast those cartoons with something more like this, which is extremely irregular and clumpy. So these are simulations of these outflows. This is the hydrogen column density here, and here is the temperature. So lots of clumpiness, wide range in temperature. These things are messy looking. right, so I told you that I'm interested in galaxies at the peak epoch of star formation. And this diagram illustrates what I mean by that. This is a plot of the star formation rate density of the universe, so star formation per unit volume, as a function of redshift or look-back time. So we're here. We can go back 13 billion years to almost the beginning of the universe. And what you see is that as we go back in time, the star formation rate per unit volume increases, reaches a peak somewhere around redshift 2, 10 billion years or so ago, and then declines again. So right around redshift 2 seems to be the most active time period in terms of star formation in galaxies. Galaxies were most actively forming stars. This is also the peak of bright quasar space density, so also accretion onto massive black holes. So it is interesting to figure out what galaxies were doing at this time, in addition to the particular galaxies that I'm talking about, which may be analogs for galaxies at even higher redshifts. There are also practical reasons why I like to observe galaxies at this redshift range. One of them has to do with how particular spectral windows of interest are shifted into bands that we can observe with our telescopes on the ground. So we have access to the rest frame UV, which is shifted into the optical, and the rest frame optical nebular emission lines are shifted into the near infrared. And I'll show you examples of both of those shortly. And also, galaxies at high redshifts are obviously faint, but galaxies at redshift of 2 or so are still bright enough so that if you happen to have a large amount of time on a large telescope, which is not that easy to get, you can still take nice high-quality spectra of them. And I'll be showing you some examples of those. So, to give you some idea of the spectral features that I'll be talking about, this is a rest frame optical spectrum of a galaxy. This is a nearby galaxy, but it just illustrates some of the features that I'll be discussing. So in the rest frame optical, in the spectrum of a star-forming galaxy, we have a bunch of emission lines. These are nebular emission lines coming from H2 regions, the ionized gas surrounding the massive stars. So we have hydrogen recombination lines. This is H beta, H alpha from the Balmer series. We have various metal emission lines, so oxygen 3. We have some nitrogen, sulfur. So the ratios of these various lines tell us important things about the physical conditions in this gas. It tells us, hopefully, by various diagnostics, the metallicity, meaning the heavy element content. What we actually usually measure is the oxygen abundance and use that as a proxy for the overall chemical enrichment. It can tell us the ionization state by measuring, for example, the ratio of doubly ionized oxygen to singly ionized oxygen, which is not on this plot, but there is a line of that that we commonly measure. We can measure electron density. These two lines are density sensitive. So all of these things like this from studying the ratios of these nebular emission lines. And at a redshift of 2, these lines are shifted into the near infrared. This is the rest frame ultraviolet spectrum of actually a composite spectrum. So this is an average of many galaxies, which means that the signal noise is higher than we typically get for individual galaxies in our surveys. But this is the rest frame UV shifted into the optical, again, at redshift 2. So there are various features that you see in this spectrum. There is the continuum, which, since we're looking in the ultraviolet, comes from stars, hot, massive stars, young stars. Superimposed on this continuum, there are a bunch of absorption lines. These are metal absorption lines, so they come from carbon, oxygen, silicon, mostly. mostly low ionization states, but there are some higher ionization states as well. This is silicon 4. This is carbon 4. So these are lines from interstellar gas in the galaxy. And there is also this feature here. This is Lyman alpha, a transition of hydrogen, which I'll be telling you a lot more about shortly. In this particular example, this is mostly an emission line, but you can see there's a little bit of absorption here as well. And in general, we see a wide variety of profiles for this feature. It can be pure absorption, it can be very strong emission, it can be any combination of the two. And this is one of the most important diagnostics that we look at. So Lyman alpha, just so we're all on the same page, this is the n equals 1 to 2 transition of hydrogen. So that means that it's a resonant line. So Lyman alpha photons undergo resonant scattering. If you have a Lyman alpha photon and it is embedded in a cloud of neutral hydrogen, it will be absorbed and re-emitted by those hydrogen atoms. And this picture over here is the resulting profile that you expect if you have a source emitting Lyman alpha photons in a static cloud of gas. So those photons will undergo small frequency shifts just because of the internal velocity of the atoms. And eventually, those frequency shifts will, if the atoms, in order to actually escape from the cloud, need to shift far enough so that they're no longer at the resonant frequency. And after a whole bunch of scatterings, that starts to happen. And what you end up with is this symmetric double-peaked profile where photons have been both redshifted and blue-shifted and eventually escape. There are different models here. This is just for different amounts of neutral hydrogen, different column densities. So that's what you get in a static medium. So I showed you that spectrum before of the UV spectrum of a galaxy with those interstellar absorption lines and that Lyman alpha emission line. And if we have a whole lot of galaxies, and if we measure the wavelengths of those features, which is a simple measurement, we actually see something very important. And it looks like this. So this is the velocity of those absorption lines relative to the velocity of one of those nebular emission lines like H alpha. So that H alpha emission line is coming from ionized gas around the massive stars. So this is basically telling you the redshift of the galaxy, the redshift of the stars. And what we see is that all of those interstellar absorption lines are blue-shifted relative to the stars. And the Lyman alpha emission lines are redshifted relative to the stars. And what this is actually telling us is that those galactic outflows that I told you about earlier are ubiquitous in star-forming galaxies at high redshifts. And that is explained by this little cartoon right here, which is that oversimplified model of these complicated outflows that I told you I was going to show you. So we have a starburst in the center of our galaxy here. This starburst is driving a galaxy-scale outflow of gas. So we're over here on Earth with our telescope. We are seeing continuum light from the stars, and then we're seeing absorption lines superimposed on that from the gas that's between us and those stars. That gas is outflowing toward us, so those lines are blue-shifted. And here's an example from a very nice, very bright, gravitationally lensed galaxy showing you one of these blue-shifted absorption lines. The Lyman alpha emission is a little bit more complicated. But the way this works is that you have your Lyman alpha photons, which are initially produced in your H2 region surrounding your massive stars. They are scattered by neutral hydrogen, as we've discussed. But they have the best chance of actually escaping the galaxy in this direction where we can observe them. When they start out going this way, they are backscattered by this receding shell of the outflow. So they start going this way, and then they've picked up a Doppler shift from from this receding shell, which means that they're no longer on resonance with the rest of the gas. So therefore, we see the Lyman alpha with this redshifted emission line. So this combination of blue-shifted absorption lines and redshifted Lyman alpha emission is telling us that these galactic scale outflows with velocities of a few hundred kilometers per second are ubiquitous in these galaxies. So I'm going to be focusing mostly on Lyman alpha emission, not entirely. And this will clearly reflect the properties of these galactic outflows. But this Lyman alpha emission profile is actually very complicated. It depends on a lot of things that's going on with your hydrogen gas. Clearly, it depends on the velocity of your outflows, but it also depends on the total amount and spatial distribution of your hydrogen gas, so covering fraction, geometry, column density, all of that. It depends on your dust content. These photons can be absorbed by dust, and if you have multiple scatterings going on, you have a greater chance of being absorbed by dust. So these photons are easily extinguished. What we do know is that, in general, this expanding outflow produces a redshifted emission line. It would be convenient if we could just map the peak of that emission line to the velocity of our outflow, but unfortunately it's not that simple because of all of these other factors. In particular, the total column density of hydrogen also has a strong effect on where that peak is. So one particular reason why we care about these Lyman alpha profiles goes back to this question of reionization and the escape of ionizing photons, which are also known as Lyman continuum photons. Both Lyman alpha photons and Lyman continuum photons are strongly affected by neutral hydrogen. So it would make sense that there might be some correlation between the Lyman alpha profile of a galaxy and whether or not Lyman continuum photons are able to get out. And our samples are very small, but it does seem like this is true. So the number of galaxies where we've actually detected directly escaping Lyman continuum radiation is, I think, less than 10. But most of them, in fact, I think possibly all of them, have strong Lyman alpha emission. This is just a sample of three right here, showing you Lyman alpha profiles of three of these. These are pretty representative. So you can see, first, that they all have strong emission. But second, you can see that two of these have not only this redshifted emission that I was telling you about, but also another peak on the blue side. So significant blue shifted emission as well. So this means that the opacity to Lyman alpha photons, this neutral hydrogen that blocks it, is lower, allowing emission to escape on the blue side of the galaxy as well as the red. And that is, maybe not surprisingly, related to the escape of these Lyman continuum photons. So this is why we're particularly interested in the Lyman alpha profile. All right, so these are some motivating questions for the work that I do. I'm not going to necessarily answer all of these today, but these are things we're thinking about. How do these ionizing photons get out of galaxies? How does that relate to outflows? How does it connect to Lyman alpha emission and the Lyman alpha profiles? How does the Lyman alpha emission relate to other things that we can measure about the galaxy, metallicity, ionization state, all of that? What do these outflows look like in low mass galaxies at high redshifts? So these are the big questions. The work that I do tries to address these through observations of these various spectral features. So I'm doing this in various ways. I'm just going to tell you about a small part of that work today, focusing on detailed observations of particular galaxies. So these are the types of data that we use. This comes from large telescopes, so most of the data that I'm going to be showing you comes from the Keck telescopes on Mauna Kea and the island of Hawaii. So we measure these rest frame optical nebular emission lines, redshifted into the near infrared, to study the physical conditions in this gas, so the metallicity, ionization state, all of these things. And then we can learn about the outflow properties and potential neutral hydrogen distribution and content from stuff in the UV. So these UV absorption lines and the Lyman alpha profile. So that's the rest from UV shifted into the optical. So I showed you a generic UV spectrum of redshift 2-ish galaxies earlier. This is the UV spectrum of a low-mass galaxy. So this is a galaxy at redshift of 2 called BX418. It's shown in black here. This is a spectrum from the low-res spectrograph on Keck with 12 hours of integration. So it takes a long time to get a spectrum like this. This galaxy has a mass of about 10 to the 9 solar masses, which is low, but not on the scale of little tiny dwarf galaxies that we see in the local group. We just do not have nearly the sensitivity to detect those at high redshifts. The red line here is that average spectrum of about 1,000 redshift 2 galaxies. So that is showing you what more typical galaxies at these redshifts, or at least the ones in our surveys, look like. So just a few different features to focus on. Here is the Lyman alpha emission. You can see we have a very strong emission line, quite a bit stronger than we have in our average spectrum. We can also look over here. You can see some other emission features. So this is an emission line from carbon. There's some oxygen here. This is an emission line from helium 2. So these emission lines arise under conditions of low metallicity and high ionization. So this low mass galaxy is not very chemically enriched. It's metallicity, metal content, is about 15% of the sun, something like that. And it's also fairly highly ionized, we think. There are also absorption lines in this spectrum. I'll zoom in on these so that you can get a better look. These ones with the boxes around them are the low ionization absorption lines. So these are elements that tend to be associated with neutral gas. And what you can see is that our galaxy BX418, shown in black, tends to have much weaker low ionization absorption lines than the average spectrum. So we do see these lines, but they are weak.
Question.
Yes?
How do you normalize the black line compared to the red line?
They are both normalized basically just by dividing out the continuum and fitting it. There's obviously some uncertainty associated with that.
Dividing out what?
By measuring the continuum level and then dividing by it. All right. These are the higher ionization absorption lines. So here is silicon 4 and carbon 4. And what you can see now is that by comparing to the average spectrum, these lines are as strong or stronger than we see in the average spectrum. You can also learn something interesting about this by studying the ratios of these two silicon 4 emission lines. So these are sensitive to the optical depth of this gas, so how easy it is for photons to get through. You can see in the red line, these lines are at about a 2-to-1 ratio, which is the optically thin case. In the black spectrum, these are about equal, the optically thick case. So there is more highly ionized gas in our low mass, low metallicity galaxy. By comparing these various absorption lines, we can conclude that the outflowing gas seems to be more highly ionized. So this is all good. We have this strong Lyman alpha emission, weak low ionization lines, strong high ionization lines, all indicating that we have highly ionized outflow, possibly a lower covering fraction of neutral hydrogen, which is interesting because it might help these Lyman continuum photons get out. It is consistent with these other features that we see that arise at low metallicities and high ionization states. But this is one galaxy. So what we'd really like to know is this typical of low metallicity galaxies at high redshifts? This is not an easy question to answer because these galaxies are relatively rare, and I told you that this takes a 12-hour spectrum on Keck. So it's a project both to find these galaxies and to get detailed data on them. So what I'm going to tell you about today is just the beginnings of beginning to answer that question. But there are a few different ways that we can address this. One thing that we've done is try to select galaxies by metallicity and ionization to try to find these highly ionized low metallicity objects directly. So this is a diagram of ratios of some of those rest frame optical emission lines. This is called the BPT diagram. Those are the first authors of who wrote a paper with this diagram in 20 years ago, something like that. So this is the ratio of one of those nitrogen lines to H alpha, oxygen line versus H beta. And what you find is that if you put a whole lot of galaxies on this diagram, they look like this. Galaxies with actively accreting black holes live up here. Star-forming galaxies form a sequence like this. And this is basically a sequence in metallicity and ionization, such that galaxies that have lower metallicities and are more highly ionized live up here. So we figured that if that is the sort of galaxies that you are interested in, you might want to look in that corner of the diagram. So here now is a plot. All of these colored points here are from a large survey of redshift 2 galaxies called the Keck Baryonic Structure Survey, where we've gotten measurements of these rest frame optical emission lines from this new multi-object near-infrared spectrograph on Keck that allows you to measure these lines for 30 galaxies at a time. I did my PhD thesis using the previous infrared spectrograph on Keck, NIRSpec, which does this for one galaxy at a time. So Mosfeier does my PhD thesis in half a night, which is great. So these gray points here are local galaxies. Here are the redshift 2 sample. And we are particularly interested in the things in the extreme upper left-hand corner here, which is where the most highly ionized and low metallicity galaxies live. So we've picked out the things in that corner from our survey. We're doing various studies of these objects. The data that we have on this sample of galaxies is variable. So the only thing that we can measure reliably for this full sample is the Lyman alpha profile, but that is shown here. And what you can see is that most of these galaxies have strong Lyman alpha emission, which, as we know, suggests lower neutral hydrogen content. That may not necessarily surprise you, but it should, actually. If you look at the strength of Lyman alpha emission from the sample as a whole. So this is a plot of the distribution of Lyman alpha equivalent width for those extreme upper left galaxies in blue and that parent sample in red. The equivalent width is just a measure of the strength of the emission line. It's the ratio of the emission line flux to the flux in the continuum. And what you can see is that most of our parent sample has a fairly low equivalent width. In fact, the most common ones have equivalent width of less than zero, which means that they have Lyman alpha in absorption. There's a class of galaxies that are classified as Lyman alpha emitters, which has been defined as having an equivalent width of 20 angstroms or greater. And actually most of these extreme galaxies are Lyman alpha emitters. The typical equivalent width is about 40 angstroms. So this is pretty high. This is significantly different than the parent sample. They're actually similar to a class of local, low metallicity, highly ionized galaxies called green peas. They look like little green dots on flown digital sky survey images, which were how they were discovered. Those might be similar objects in the local universe. So this is good, but we would like to look at these galaxies in more detail, learn more things about them from better spectra. And this is the part that's work in progress. We're still working on getting really nice spectra of these galaxies. So I'm going to show you some more detailed observations of just two of them. So one of them is BX418, the galaxy that I showed you before, only we've now gotten some better data on it. And then there's another galaxy that lives right here in this same corner called BX660. These are what these two galaxies look like as seen by the Hubble Space Telescope. They are small, compact, not doing very much. They have similar stellar masses, a few times 10 to the 9 solar masses, so fairly small. They have high star formation rates. They have low metallicity, so this is the oxygen abundance, which we use as a proxy for the overall chemical enrichment. This is 20% of solar, about 20% of solar. This here is the ratio of oxygen 3 to oxygen 2, so that's a measure of the ionization, and these numbers are pretty high compared to the average sample, so these galaxies are also pretty highly ionized. We have better UV spectra of these things, so we can look for these other UV emission lines, which are showing up in low metallicity, highly ionized galaxies, so these carbon, oxygen, nebular helium 2. We see in both of these objects. We can look at their Lyman alpha profiles. And now we see a difference, which turns out to be interesting. This is a higher resolution, low res spectrum of BX418 in blue and BX660 in red. There is actually also an archival spectrum of BX418 from the X-shooter spectrograph on the VLT in Chile, which has higher spectral resolution. So you can see that this actually resolves into two nice peaks. It has a significant blue peak. That might remind you of those Lyman continuum emitting galaxies that I showed you earlier. If we look at BX660, though, there's not much in the way of blue shifted emission at all. So that's a potentially significant difference if we're interested in the neutral hydrogen content and distribution and the escape of Lyman continuum photons. We can also look at the absorption lines. So these are the things that are telling us about the properties of galactic outflows. These are the high ionization lines, silicon 4 in particular. They are similarly strong in both objects, but we can look at the maximum blue shifted velocity that we observe for these lines. And we find that for BX418, we have high ionization outflowing gas that reaches velocities of about 1,300 kilometers per second, which is pretty fast. For BX660, this number is about 600 or 700, which is typical of the sample. So we appear to have a high velocity, highly ionized outflow in BX418, but not in our other guy. We can also compare the low ionization absorption lines. These are a little bit messy, but you can see that they clearly vary in strength. BX418, the one with blue shifted Lyman alpha emission, high velocity, high ionization gas, has weak low ionization lines compared to our other galaxy. So its outflow is more highly ionized, which I told you before. We sort of knew that already from our earlier data. So this is only two objects, but even from this sample of two, there are some interesting implications. And that is that galaxies that are very similar in a lot of ways, so similar metallicities, masses, morphologies, extreme emission line ratios, ionization states, can still have different properties if you look at things related to outflowing gas and Lyman alpha. So if you're looking for likely Lyman continuum emitters, just selecting by metallicity and ionization state is not enough. It doesn't tell you the whole story. I think this is not really a surprise. These are mostly due to effects involving the outflow and surrounding neutral hydrogen. But here are a couple of signatures that we might want to be looking for in addition to metallicity and ionization and stuff that might point us at these most extreme objects that would be most likely to have this Lyman continuum emission. So that is this highly ionized outflow, weak low ionization absorption lines, some blue-shifted Lyman alpha emission. I want to tell you about one more galaxy just in the last couple of minutes here. This is some work that my postdoc Danielle is doing. This is an even more extreme object. So this is a galaxy that's gravitationally lensed. So it is, this is a not too distant massive elliptical galaxy. And behind that galaxy is a very low mass star-forming galaxy which is lensed into this arc. And that lensing magnifies it by about a factor of 30, which means that it's much, much brighter than it would be without that lensing, and we can get really nice data on it. This is also in a field that there has been a whole lot of nice Hubble Space Telescope data taken on. So these are multicolor images from the CANDLES program on the Hubble Space Telescope. It has also been observed with this slitless GRISM spectrograph on HST. So that is actually what this is. This is a spectrum from the GRISM. So these, you can see the arc here. This is the oxygen 3 emission line, one of those nebular emission lines shifted into the near infrared. And it is extremely strong, has extremely high equivalent width. So basically, this galaxy is quite low mass, about 10 to the 8th solar masses. So this is an order of magnitude less massive than the ones that I was talking to you about earlier. It is even lower in metallicity. It is very young, but forming stars very rapidly, we think. So we went to Keck and got a nice spectrum of this galaxy with a low-res spectrograph. It looks like this, which is basically an even more extreme version of the spectra that I showed you before. Extremely strong Lyman alpha, emission lines from these other things that show up under these conditions. So here's our helium 2, oxygen, carbon. This is also some carbon 4 emission here. And I'll focus on just a few of the interesting features of this spectrum. We're doing a lot more analysis, which is still in progress. But I'll point out just a couple of things. First, this is what the Lyman alpha profile looks like. And this is quite interesting. This should look different than all of the other Lyman alpha profiles that I've showed you before. It is double peaked, but it is very symmetric. And in fact, the bluer peak is just slightly stronger than the red peak, which means that the Lyman alpha profile shows no evidence for these galactic outflows that are otherwise ubiquitous in these galaxies. And in fact, if we look at the absorption lines, we see the same thing. There are absorption lines in this galaxy. They're pretty weak. They are not blue shifted. They are actually pretty much at zero velocity. So if we compare the velocity structure of these various features, this is one of those nebular emission lines from ionized gas surrounding the stars. These in black are those low ionization absorption lines. You can see that they have just about identical velocity profile. And then here is the double-peaked Lyman alpha. So there is no evidence for outflowing gas in this galaxy. And given that these galactic outflows are thought to correlate with the density of star formation, and given that this galaxy seems to have a high star formation rate in a small volume, this is surprising. You would expect this galaxy to have outflows. There are various reasons why this could be happening, possibly it's so young that it just hasn't had time for these things to develop. Maybe there are geometrical effects, so we're just not looking at it from the right angle. We don't know yet. Here is just a little bit more work in progress on this galaxy. We also just got some narrowband imaging covering the Lyman alpha emission line from the Hubble Space Telescope. So we expect these Lyman alpha photons to be resonantly scattered both in frequency and in space. So their velocity structure gets modified, but also their spatial structure. They will be re-emitted from wherever they're being scattered. So they can tell us about the neutral hydrogen distribution. So we have, this is an image of the Lyman alpha emission plus the continuum. Here is the continuum in an adjacent filter. We haven't done the quantitative analysis yet, but even just by comparing these two by eye, you can see that the Lyman alpha emission looks a little bit fuzzier. And that's because of that resonant scattering. So we'll be comparing this distribution to the continuum and to that oxygen 3 emission line that you saw in the Grism spectra to try to figure out what's happening with the scattering of the Lyman alpha photons. And finally, just to zoom in on these very pretty UV emission lines, of particular interest here is this strong, narrow helium 2 and the carbon 4, which require a hard ionizing spectrum, possibly produced by these very low metallicity stars. We're also playing a little bit with photoionization models involving black holes and accretion as well. So this is work in progress. All right, I think that I am running out of time, so I will just put up another simplified cartoon here of this galactic scale outflow, but this is a little bit more of what we think might be going on in these more extreme low mass objects. So you can see that our neutral portion of the outflow is no longer completely covering our source. Our outflow is more highly ionized, which gives you potential channels where the Lyman continuum emission might start to escape. And that's associated with weaker absorption lines when you look at the low ionization lines and some blue peaks to your Lyman alpha emission. So these are properties and quantities that we're looking for that are likely to be tied to this escape of Lyman continuum photons. We're still working on building up a statistical sample of these galaxies to figure out how prevalent these properties actually are. Thank you.
We have time for a few questions.
Yes.
What's your chance of getting more of these really special galaxies that are gravitational lens?
The lensed ones. There are, even among lens galaxies, this particular one is unusual because it's so low in mass. But I think the chances are good. In fact, Greg and I spent a little while last summer trying to predict how many lens galaxies would be found by the LSST telescope, which is going to be doing this deep imaging survey in the next few years. And we predicted, what, hundreds of thousands or something like that. Getting nice spectra of them is more of a challenge. But I think given all the future facilities over the long term, there'll be a lot more of these.
So I have a question. I mean, when you look at your narrowband image of this lens, it looked like they were on the right-hand panel. It looked like there were equivalent width variations. I mean, you see kind of the lower part of that. I mean, it looks like it gets really fainter, the lower part of the arc on the right-hand image. And so I guess I'm curious. I mean, this thing is 2 arc seconds long, so you can put 2 slits down and actually look for variation, spatial variations along the lens by putting a slit here and here. Because it looked like from the scale bar in your previous plot, it's 2 arc seconds in extent.
Right.
And you can look for spatial variations in this galaxy.
Because
you saw clear color variations in the color. Image.
Right.
There was a big red clump.
Yeah, it's interesting. So I think
upper left, you see clear.
Yeah, color. So this here actually shows you the lensing model. And the lensing model says that there are these two clumps, A and B, but they're very blended together. So this is A and B, and this is also A and B. So it's weird the way that, so there are issues with the
lensing model?
Yeah, or with, I mean, just because you look at two separate parts of the arc, you're not actually necessarily looking at two different sources.
They have very different colors. That must imply then that you have very high, that must alone tell you a very high spatial variability in kind of the covering fraction. And
Okay. Yeah. We're still interpreting all of this.
Yeah, that's right.
So for the RISM plot on the right there, do you have to assume something about the shape of the galaxy in order to separate out the lines that you see? Because it looks like it's all kind of, it looks like the spatial extent of the galaxy is mixed with the spectrum.
Yes, it is. So this is, it's basically if you just take an image of the galaxy and then smear it out in wavelength. So fortunately, we do know what the galaxy looks like, so you can map different parts of the galaxy to different parts of the spectrum. But that is what's going on.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much, Don.
Thank you. Sure, it's fun.